हेलो सीमा मैम, हेलो कैन यू हियर मी?
आफ्टरनून
गुड आफ्टरनून मैम, सीमा
गुड
मैम,
आफ्टरनून मैम।
अलका मैम, आई थिंक सो सीमा मैम इज नॉट देयर फॉर अ मोमेंट।
ओके
या शी वाज आस्किंग, आई थिंक देयर वाज अ ट्रेनिंग, नो?
या देयर वाज अ ट्रेनिंग।
वेरी वेल
ना मैम, सर इज देयर सेशन।
ओके ma'am, with your due permission, may we start?
Yes, from Savinda.
Okay. Leadership is the ability to guide others without force into a direction or decision that leaves them still feeling empowered and accomplished. A very good morning, everyone. I accord a warm welcome to you all to this important session of Salman Education Trust CPT program, a session on leadership. We are honored to have amongst us Swantran leader Manish Kumar. We are all indeed privileged that today, sir, has spared his valuable time to be with us and mentor us. Sir is a veteran pilot from the Air Force, an alumni of XLRI, and the author of best-selling book Be Your Own Pilot, which is being appreciated internationally. He is empaneled as the mental training expert of Sports Authority of India for the mental conditioning of Olympic athletes and other sportsmen. He is also an internationally recognized motivational speaker and has spoken to the executives of various companies and also to students of various colleges, institutes and schools. He has appeared on Doordarshan, Inner Child Radio, AIR, Radio Dhoom, Dhamal, Mantra and Big FM. He is on the editorial board of the magazine Fly High, and he writes a motivational column in the newspaper. We welcome you, sir, and thank you for being with us this morning. The topic for the workshop today is how to engineer your believers to success. May I now request Manish, sir, to enrich us with his experience and expertise. It's over to you, sir. I would request all the participants to please mute their camera, headphones, mute themselves. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
We history teachers were asked us the same question. The question was, what is your job? One of them said, oh, I'm just teaching history to my students. The second one said, I'm in the business of education. But the third one said, I'm shaping the destiny of the nation. I'm here to teach my students to make history. So first of all, I thank Ms. Bhavna for the introduction, and I'm thankful to Ms. Sigma for inviting me to interact with you all. I'll be speaking on belief engineering, and I'll be covering this webinar in three parts. First, I'll tell you what is belief. Second, I'll tell you some recent research that has gone on developing belief and what belief does to us. And then I'll go on to say how to empower your strong beliefs and how to delete your disempowering beliefs. And I give you the tools and techniques of planting a belief in your mind. So before I start, let me tell you what was not covered in the introduction. As you know, I was a helicopter pilot. I served the Air Force for almost 14 years. I joined the Air Force with the belief that one day I will save some lives. and it happened in 1999 when there was a severe cyclone in Gujarat, and I got a chance to save around 5 lives. After that, in the next year, that is 2000, one of our helicopters crashed, and the wreckage was in the effect, and I got a chance to save 7 more lives. And after I achieved what I had set out to achieve, I had something known as the Olympian's remorse. An Olympic athlete works hard for years, and when he achieves his aim, he doesn't have anything to look forward to. Same was my case. But I believe that there is something more to life than to some only flying from place A to place B. So I quit my job in 2006, looking for meaning in life. I got on to writing this book called Be Your Own Pilot, with the belief that the book will become a bestseller one day. But after almost 6-7 months, when I looked at the figures, the book had sold almost only around 60 copies on Flipkart. And I had invested all my money, all my energy in promoting the book. So I was getting into something known as, you can call it a depression. I was slightly slipping into depression. Then I got the chance to read about a guy called Captain Coffee Gerald. His story is, he had taken off, there were two pilots who had taken off from USS Kitty Hawk during the Vietnam War to bomb Hanoi. And their aircraft were shot down and both the pilots were captured. They were placed into solitary confinement in a cell of 6 feet by 3 feet with their bodies tied to cement slabs, and they were beaten by rusted shackles. They were being tortured for information. One of the pilots endured the torture for 7 days, and he believed that there is no more to live, and he committed suicide. And Dr. Coffee Gerald, he endured the torture for almost 7 years with the belief that one day things will be better. He had belief in himself, he had belief in the Almighty, and he went on to tell the story. The second thing that came to my mind was about a lady known as Hulda Crooks. Hulda Crooks and her friend retired at the age of 70, while her friend thought that 70 is the final age when you can't think of anything else in life, it's time to retire. But Hulda Crooks thought there is more to life than just retire at 70. So she picked up mountaineering. And between the age of 70 to 91, she climbed Mount Whitney almost 23 times and went on to climb Mount Fuji at the age of 91. Closer home, when I was suffering from the so-called depression, I came to know of a girl called Arunima Sinha. If you have heard of Arunima Sinha, you will recall that in 2011, she was thrown out of a train. There were robbers who wanted to rob her out of her golden chain. She was resisting it. She did not allow them to rob it. And they threw her out of the running train onto the adjacent track. And there was another train coming on that track, and that cut her leg. Her leg was cut below the level of the knee. And she was on the track for almost the whole night. In the morning, the villagers came and they took her to the hospital. The story is long, but I'll cut it short. Her leg was amputated from the knee below, and on the right leg, there were rods put. And in the media, there was a story of Arunima Sinha, because Arunima Sinha was a national level volleyball player. There was a story of Arunima Sinha trying to commit suicide. So Arunima decided that she wanted to do something. She had the belief that she can shut up the entire media. So she wrote to Miss Bajendri Pal that, "Ma'am, I am an amputee, but I want to climb the Mount Everest." Miss Bajendri Pal told her that, "Listen, girl, you have the belief, the very fact that you have the belief that you can conquer Mount Everest, you have already conquered the Mount Everest. It's only for the world to see the day when you actually climb it." And on 21st May 2013, not even 2 years from the day she was thrown out of the train, she climbed the Mount Everest, and she went on to climb many more mountains. So ladies and gentlemen, this is the power of belief. I believed in her story, and I also overcame my depression, and slowly and gradually my book became a bestseller in 2013, almost 2 years after Arunima, almost the same time Arunima had conquered the Mount Everest. So I became a serious student of what is belief. The belief changes. Belief is a sense of certainty. If you are certain that if you move the handle clockwise, the door will open. If you turn the steering handle to the right, the car will go to the right. So I found out that belief is something. Belief is the unquestioned command to our nervous system. Belief is the filters through which we perceive reality. If I can tell you, the belief is like an idea that is like a tabletop, and it's got reference legs. If you have the belief that you are intelligent, your reference legs may be that your teachers have told you that you are intelligent, your parents have told you that you are intelligent, your friends tell you that you are intelligent, and even the marks that you would have got in your schools and colleges, they go on to prove that you are intelligent. This happens because when we have certain belief, we tap our resources, we tap our potential, and that gives us results, and that again goes on to strengthen our beliefs that we have. So beliefs are three types. Beliefs you can call a belief as a simple opinion. And when you have an opinion, they have the tabletop has no legs or has very weak legs. Suppose I tell you that Jodha Akbar, suppose we take the example of a movie called Jodha Akbar. If you say that Jodha Akbar is a good movie, it's simply an opinion. You may watch the movie or hear it from somebody else that it's a bad movie. Your opinion might change. Similarly, the belief has got legs. It's got legs that can be strengthened. And on the third is conviction. When you have certain beliefs that you can't be questioned, even people who have beliefs, people get angry if their beliefs are questioned, their conviction is questioned. That is what is conviction. Some people have the conviction that if they kill kafirs, if they kill innocent people, they'll get 72 hoors in Jannat. That is their conviction. And because of that conviction, they go on to kill innocent lives. So I will tell you how you can convert your beliefs into conviction in the later part. So there's a lot of research recently that has gone on the power of belief. There's a person known as, there's a professor known as Dr. Bernie Siegel. He is in the Yale University. He has done a lot of research on people with multiple personality disorder. If any one of you would have seen the movie Me, Myself and Irene, you will recall that in the movie, the hero is Jim Carrey. In the movie, half of the time he believes that he is a police officer, Charlie, and half the other time he believes that he is a guy called Hanks. And this is what happens when you believe something. He found out that if a person suffering from multiple personality disorder believes that he is X and it changes over to Y, his biochemistry changes. Even the color of his eyes change. His entire body changes. Even symptoms like diabetes and heart disease tend to appear on a person who believes when he is manifesting some other personality. Why am I telling you this? Is because you can implant a belief in a student and change his entire personality. The same research was carried out by Dr. Maxwell March. He has written a book called Psycho-Cybernetics. He says that our belief or our self-image is the basic ingredient that helps us achieve our goals. There's a lot of research carried out on placebo. There's a doctor in Harvard University, called Dr. Henry Beecher. he took 100 students and he divided them into two groups, and in one group he gave them a capsule telling them that it was it was super stimulant, and in the other group he gave the students a capsule that was supposed to be super depressant, and they were made to have that capsule. And when they were tested after 2-3 hours, these people were actually behaving as if they had the super stimulant or super depressant. That is, their body overrode the medicine. And the fact was, they had not got any medicine. That was an empty capsule that was given to them. That is the power of belief. There's a psychologist called Dr. Ellen Langer. She has written a beautiful book called Counterclockwise, or The Power of Possibility. She says that even our DNA changes according to our beliefs. What she did was, she had taken around some 50 senior citizens around from the age of 70 to 90. She had put them in a studio sort of setup, in which the whole atmosphere was of 1940s. The architecture was of 1940s. The furniture was of 1940s. The movies that were being shown, the TV shows that were being shown on the TV, were of the 1940s. The magazines that they were that were there were of 1940s. And these people of, you know, senior citizens of more than 70, 80, 90 years old, when they came to the setup, they came on crutches, they came on wheelchairs, they came on walking sticks, they came with their specs, they came with their hearing aids. And they were told that believe as if you are in your 40s, get rid of all your wheelchairs or your walking sticks or your specs or your hearing aids, and believe as if you are in your 40s. And believe me, when these guys were tested after almost 6 weeks, almost 80% of them had gotten rid of their walking sticks, their wheelchairs. People who were not able to hear, they were able to hear clearly without the hearing aids. People who had problems seeing without specs were able to see without specs. So that is the power of belief. And science says now doctors are believing that the DNA changes. There's a scientist called Dr. Bruce Lipton. He has written a beautiful book called Biology of Belief. He says that the switching on and switching off of DNAs in our cells is because of the external stimulus, that is our beliefs. So that is the power of belief. Belief can make a man, or belief can break a man. So whatever you believe, if you believe you are young, you'll remain young. If you believe you are rich, you will remain rich. If you believe that you are a good professional, you will be a good professional. Now, let's move on to how do we strengthen our beliefs. Like I told you, beliefs are three types. Beliefs are your opinions, beliefs are your actual beliefs, and beliefs are conviction. So how do we change our beliefs into conviction? First of all, you should know what is your belief. In my workshops, because of short of time, was told to curtail it, but in my workshop, what I do is I ask people to write their empowering beliefs. You write your 10 empowering beliefs, take the first three, and start adding reference legs. That if you believe, the example that I gave you, if you believe that you are intelligent, what makes you think that you are intelligent? Your parents told you that you are intelligent, your friends tell you that you are intelligent. Similarly, start adding legs, start adding reference legs. Taking IQ tests and saying that your beliefs are turning onto conviction. This is how you turn a normal belief into conviction. The second part is, how do we change this? I'll cover it in detail. How do we change our normal beliefs? How do we get rid of our limiting beliefs? There's a psychologist His name is Dr. Martin Seligman. He tried an experiment. What he did was he took some dogs and he put them on a table and he covered them with a box and he administered little shocks to them. And the dogs tried to leave, but they could not leave. After some time, the box was removed and again shocks was administered to the dogs. And the dogs didn't even try to leave. This is a theory that propounded. It's called it learned helplessness. We think that our beliefs, our limiting beliefs, are either pervasive, permanent, or personal. So in another experiment, what he did was he took a fish and put it in an aquarium. And he was feeding the fish. The fish food was given to the fish on a regular interval. After some time, what he did was he put a glass plate in between the aquarium and the fish food was given on the other side of the aquarium on which the fish was there. The fish tried to break the glass table or knock at the glass table a few times. And after some time, the fish gave up. And once the fish gave up, the glass table was removed. But the fish food was being given continuously on the other side of the aquarium. But the fish has got so used to of not trying that the fish stopped trying and the fish died. So this is what happens when we face problems, when we face the limiting belief, we feel that it is permanent. If you have the belief that you cannot get up in the morning, go for a walk, or you cannot go to the gym, you will have the belief that you cannot get up in the morning. It is as if it is permanent, that your condition is permanent. And the second is pervasive. You feel that your entire life is filled with that same problem. Suppose if you have a financial problem, if you believe you have a financial problem, you'll start believing that the financial problem will ruin the chances of the student, your kids getting education, and that might lead to a divorce. So that is, the problem is pervasive. The same problem is covering your entire life. And the third problem is personal. If you have faced failures, if you have faced failure a number of times, you start feeling that there is something wrong with you. It's not that I have messed up, but you start feeling that I mess up. To counter this problem, counter this limiting belief, first of all, you have to decide, what do you want to change? It's said that half of the problem is solved by just knowing what you want to do in life. You have to ask yourself questions that, what is this belief costing me financially? What is this belief costing me physically? What is this belief costing my relationship? What will be this belief cost after 20, 30 years if I don't change this belief? To give you an example, if you have the belief that you cannot go for a morning walk, you cannot go to the gym, it will, in the long run, it will cost you financially. You'll have a disease and that has to be taken care of. The hospital bills will mount up and that will cost you financially. So the first thing is to know how this limiting belief is going to cost you. The second thing is, doubt all the reference legs that you have. I even ask people that, ask yourself 5 times why. Why do you believe this to be true? Suppose if somebody is a smoker and he feels that he cannot quit smoking, he has to ask himself why he cannot quit. The answer may be, I have smoked for almost 10, 15 years. I cannot quit. And again, you ask, why have you smoked for 10, 15 years? And then by this way, you keep loosening your legs. You keep weakening your legs. And the third step is, you have an emotional trigger. In the example that I gave you of a smoker or a person who is not healthy, who needs to exercise, you have to have this emotional trigger. Suppose you are going to a doctor and the doctor says that if you don't go quit smoking or start exercising, within 6 months you are going to die. And that is the sort of emotional trigger you have to accustom yourself. You have to put it in your system to make yourself work. And the change in belief doesn't happen in the future. It happens in the now. So you have to have a sense of urgency. You have to begin changing now. It is said that if you have a good enough why, you will change anyhow. And once you begin to change your beliefs, once you start a new belief, repeat it a number of times. You know what happens when we start something new? There's something known as myelin sheath. There is the myelin sheath in the brain. The sheath is the deposit of chemicals. When we practice some things a number of times, the sheath gets thicker and thicker. It is something like It's something like walking on a forest. Once you walk on the forest, the grass gives away the small path that is generated. After some time, the path becomes bigger. When the path becomes bigger, you know, the traffic start moving on the path. When the traffic start moving, the path is turned onto a road, and later on the road is turned onto a highway, and after some time the path becomes a super highway. So myelin sheath is like the super highway of your intelligence and information. So if you practice certain things time and again, if you don't have a habit of going for an exercise, when you get up in the morning, you just tell yourself that I have to go without asking, without rationalizing. No, I will go tomorrow. I'm very tired today. I cannot go today. I'll go tomorrow. I'll go day after. You just begin whatever action you have to take, the belief that you have to implant, you have to implant it then and there. At the very moment, you have to do it. And you have to repeat this a number of times till it becomes consistent. So this is how you change. This is how you empower. This is how you strengthen an empowering belief. And this is how you change a negative belief. Now we come to the crux of my talk here. I have formalized a system that is known as IVR. To implant a belief, to implant a positive belief in you. The IVR stands for idealize, visualize, and realize. So before I tell you the nitty-gritty of the system of IVR, let me tell you how the brain functions. If you are aware, the brain functions at four different levels. It functions at the beta level, it functions at the alpha level, it functions at the theta level, and it functions at the delta level. So when we are doing our day-to-day work, our brain, it's been scientifically proven on the EEG electroencephalograph that this is a scientific information that I'm sharing with you, that when you are at the beta level, when you are working, you are doing your day-to-day work, the brain function at the beta level and the frequency is 12 to 16 hertz. When you are bodily relaxed, and I'm telling you, relaxation is very important. When you relax, when you are mentally and physically relaxed, you are taking some deep breath, the brain goes into alpha state and the frequency is 8 to 12 hertz. When you get into meditation, the frequency further reduces to 4 to 8 hertz. And when you get into samadhi, you would have heard of people, you would have heard of sadhus and saints who are buried deep into the soil and they live there for months together. And if a doctor comes and examines them, the doctor will say that they are clinically dead. So they are in the state of samadhi or the state of delta waves and the frequency is 0 to 4 hertz. So we are not sadhus and saints who can get into theta or delta state, but I take people into the alpha state and implant the positive beliefs in them. So this practice, this technique that I'm going to tell you now is called the IVR, the idealize, visualize, and realize. It's practiced by the best of the golfers, it's practiced by the astronauts, it's practiced by pilots, it's practiced by the world-known athletes. You would have seen in a golf tournament, you would have seen the player before taking the shot, he moves back and then he he practices 2-3 times and then he takes the shot. That is the power of that is the power of IVR. So what I do in my workshop, what I tell people is, if you can relax on the bed on your back and close your eyes, start taking deep breaths. Once you start taking deep breaths, your breath will become smooth after some time. After around 3-4 minutes, your breath will become smooth. When your breath becomes smooth, you focus your attention on your toes, extend your toes outwards, hold it for 5 seconds and relax. Then you pull it inwards, hold it for 5 seconds and relax. Then you move upwards, you tighten your calf muscles for 5 seconds and relax. Then move on to your thigh muscles. Again, you do the same thing. You tighten your thigh muscles for 5 seconds and relax. And do the same with your stomach muscles and your chest muscles and with your facial muscles. After this, you scan your body from top to down and to see if all the muscles are relaxed or not. After this, what you have to do is imagine your most ideal situation, your most ideal belief. Suppose you're slightly unfit and you want to be fit. So your ideal situation is you are at your ideal weight. Your body is looking in a particular way. You have the image in your mind. Imagine clearly in every detail. And then you visualize using all your senses. Use your eyes, use your ears, use your taste buds, use your nose, and use all your muscles, use all your senses to make a video, make it a moving image of a video. And when you do it a number of times, you will feel, when you do it a number of times, like I told you about the myelin sheath, it will strengthen your myelin sheath and it will, you'll realize whatever you are trying to imagine. And this is the technique of IVR, and this I have found very, very powerful. And I have trained shooters who are on the Olympic level. And by doing this IVR exercise, they have got very good results. And if you have some sportsmen who is at the national level or even in state level, you can make these students practice this IVR. This is the power of this technique called idealize, visualize, and realize. So with this, I'm coming to the end of my talk. I'll just sum up the whole thing that we started with what is belief and what are the types of belief. Then we went on to find what are the latest research work going on the power of belief. And then we went on to see how can we strengthen our positive beliefs and how can we delete our negative beliefs. And finally, I told you how to practice, what are the techniques of practicing this beautiful technique called IVR. With this, I've finished. And if you have any questions, I'll love to answer them.
I would request all the participants, if they have any question, please raise their hands.
Can I ask something, sir?
Yeah, please.
I feel you're right. Yes, if we believe strongly in something, we are able to achieve that. But even if we are strongly motivated, there are some days or some time zones when you feel low and you give up, and then again you become motivated. So how to ensure that we are always in that enthusiastic state? Because like even if you want to achieve something, sometimes it may happen that you have a low phase. So how to cope up with that low phase?
Ma'am, the difference between a successful man and a failure is how quickly he bounces off from the low phases. You know, everybody has low phases. You talk of anybody, you talk to any sportsman, they have their low days, they have their high days. But the trick is how quickly you, the, there's a scientist known as, I'll call him a scientist, is known as Dr. Vincent Peale, Dr. Normal Vincent Peale, if you've heard of him, is the master of positive thinking. He says, when you feel low, let yourself feel low. Okay. You let yourself feel low that I don't have this. I don't even have this. I don't even have this. Then you start counting your blessings. Okay. That I still have this. I still have a roof over my head. I still have food to eat. I still have clothes to wear. And believe me, you know, gratitude is, I speak on gratitude a lot. Gratitude is something that's very close to my heart. The more grateful you are to whatever you have, and I'm telling you with my personal belief, your low phases will be very low. And to give you another thing that that I firmly believe that every adversity has a seed of equal or greater opportunity or prosperity. So anytime you feel low, and you will see, you know, after this talk, you'll see that any negative situation, it's negative. Every negative situation is a flag that is pointing you out to something positive. So if you have that belief, and if you ask my sisters, they will tell you that they have the belief that their work will never stop. Nothing can stop their work, or they can never, you know, nobody will stop them from achieving what they have. I have ingrained this belief in them. And just to give you an example, a quick example, one of my sisters was unsure of the date on which she was supposed to travel. And when somebody notified her, the train was almost, you know, 2 hours away. So from Noida to station is around, Delhi station, around 2 hours or something. So when she was half an hour to the station, that the time of the train was already gone. Okay. And the person who was escorting her told her, you know, let's go back. You know, there's no point in going to the station. The train would have left. He said, no, but my bhaiya says that nothing wrong will ever happen to me. That's the belief, you know. And when they reached the platform, the train was, you know, moving, you know, the train was passing. So he said, see, the train is passing. We can't climb a running train or something. And believe me, the train, the bogey on which they were about to board, that stopped right in front of them. And I'm telling you, you know, I forgot to mention this. You know, it depends on your belief of time. There are two beliefs of time. One is known as the Newtonian's belief, and another is known as the Einstein's belief. So Newtonian belief, the Newtonian theory says that time is short. I'm always running short of time. I always feel lack of time. And the other says that time is, Einstein said that it is me who creates time. So when you have that feeling of creating time, nothing, even if you miss the flight, it'll be for something good, you know? So, and this belief, what, getting back to your question, that the moment you have, you know, I tell people that the biggest thing is, you know, you have to watch your thoughts. Because of lack of time, I was supposed to cover it, but I was told to cut it short. The greatest thing is to control your thoughts. So, and it is said that the positivity ratio is 1:4. If you have to work, as if you have to survive, I'm not even saying thrive, I'm saying survive. If you have to just survive as a as a normal person, your positivity ratio of positive to negative thoughts should be 1:4. For every negative thought, you have to have 4 positive thoughts. And when I was trying this, what I used to do, I used to move around with a rubber band in my hand and on my wrist. And every time I had a negative thought, I used to, you know, pick up and release it just to remind myself that I had a negative thought. And to be successful. Okay.
So I would like to say here something to Sunita, and I think all my wonderful colleagues, that what she's saying is absolutely right. We cannot stay motivated every day. Even the happiness state is not a permanent state. And sometimes there are bad days, as you have also pointed out. Sometimes they're bad days, sometimes they're good days. But the idea is that to let this thought also pass, that today something has happened to my life, which has caused a lot of unhappiness to me, but this shall pass. And this is, it does pass. So I think we all go through that. I mean, that is just fine. So thank you so much for sparing your time.
Seema ma'am, just one.
Yes.
Can I just? I'm Anuradha Mathur here.
Yes.
My compliments to you, sir, for a very good talk. Don't you think these positive beliefs you're talking about is quite close to the writer of the book Secret,
Rhonda
Byrne.
Yeah. And even Norman Vincent Peale.
Yes, yeah, they also
have written amazing things.
Yeah.
So they also talk about part of your belief, and whatever you believe and you kind of imbibe it into yourself,
exactly.
You will succeed. Yeah, so I think what you just was speaking, I was reminded of that book, which was very close to that. Thank you.
So may I ask one question?
Of the Norman Vincent Peale, because what you mentioned about the positive thinking, and it was almost 40, 50 years back when these wonderful books were written, and they have remained the classic for the positive thinking. So what Rhonda Byrne wrote in The Secret, is it the same thing which the Norman Vincent Peale had said decades back, but people got more carried away by Rhonda Byrne because it became a bestseller. So what you're saying, that oftentimes what we do not understand is that enough is available to us through a classic literature. There is so much which is available to us. The only thing is to put it in practice and to remind us this too shall pass. And the worst times have passed. Worst things have gone. We have just been steady and things have gone ahead of us. And we have been absolutely stoic. So this talk reminded me of Norman Vincent Peale, and probably I visit those books from my library and doubt that is there anything that I have left out from there. Jyotsna had a question. Jyotsna,
yes.
You would like to ask something?
Yes, my question, sir, because I have read both Norman Vincent Peale as well as The Secret. The point is that, like you said, you also train athletes to use this IVR technique. The thing is, if two athletes, visualize the same thing, that they are going to stand first in a race, they both are visualizing the same, but yet only one will win. So what kind of makes that difference, since both of them are using the same technique?
Absolutely.
I couldn't get your name.
I'm Jyotsna Grover from Silvan Rajendra Nagar.
Miss Jyotsna, I'll tell you the difference between a winner and a gold medalist and a silver medalist is very marginal, but it depends on three things: is the emotional intensity with which you pursue something, and the repetitions you have, and and the certainty you have, and the degree of certainty you have about achieving the result. For some people, they are very sure, they are like, even if you wake them up in their dreams or, they are obsessed with whatever the passion is. I'm not talking only athletics or, their passion is education. They are passionate about education. They are continuously thinking about it, planning about it. So I'll just say three things: certainty, degree of certainty, emotional intensity, how much you are emotionally involved in the result.
Okay, sir.
So one question, sir, I would like to pose to you.
Yeah, please.
Hello? Okay. Having heard what you have said about belief and faith in one's own self, also please enlighten me about this concept that we have about spirituality and fate. You believe in destiny. People say this is destiny. And you're saying you have the power in you to change your destiny. So where is the role of the great God in all this?
May I know your name, please?
I am Mukul Jha. I'm from GD Salwan.
Mukul Jha. Miss Mukul. We have a very senior surgeon, neurosurgeon in our city. His name is Dr. Narayan. So he asked me one simple question. Hey, young man, what is the difference between, fate and free will, So as usual, I didn't have any answer. So he said the fate is, the cards that you are given. Okay. And free will is the way you deal with those cards. So destiny is what is given to us. You know, life is our gift of, you know, our gift from God. And what we give it back is our gift back to God. So that is the difference between...
So if fate is given by God, then everything is mapped for us, don't you believe?
I'll tell you, if you get on to a certain level, if you start reading Zen philosophy and all, you know, things, we get to a certain level, your things start coming to you and you have to just act as if you are, you know, working hard. The day that realization happens that on a quantum level, you know, the moment you, if I may ask, what is your aim now in life?
Well, I'm somewhere at the top already. I don't know. Rashmi, tell me. I just want to keep growing all the time, every day. I want to get better at my work.
Okay. Suppose somebody has, you know, like you to talk of athletic, the previous person who asked the question talked of the athletics and all. So if the person says, if the person starts believing that he can get the gold medal, on a quantum level, he's already got the gold medal. Okay. So he just has to, you know, continue to do that, you know, do the like acting of trying to get the gold medal. Okay. So fate is, whatever your fate is there, to reach there also, you have to, you have to do some so-called acting, or, you know, you have to do some certain actions to reach there. Otherwise, that fate will also, you know, fate will also vanish, change. And if you get into karmas, and it's another theory, you know, depending on your past karmas, present karmas and all. So fate also, you know, I personally believe fate changes. And your belief changes your fate.
So with this, we come to an end of this session. Thank you so much for enlightening us on the self-belief and self-esteem. And also, without actually naming, you did talk about the Maslow's needs hierarchy of management. And exactly. As a student of management once, while I was studying for MBA, I read that what Norman Vincent Peale says about self-belief, management talks about it in the form of the self-fulfilling prophecy. So that is exactly what I think whenever I feel down and out. And like my colleague has said, that there are days when we feel down and out, but then we are reminded of, open your diary, look at those wonderful notes which one had written, and go through them and remind us that this is life. This is how life will go on. And Mukul had asked a very, very wonderful question, that what then is the role of destiny? So the art of good session is to leave us with more questions. And you have certainly left us with more questions. Thank you so much. And we hope to hear from you some other time again. And on behalf of the Salwan Education Trust and my colleagues who are in this program, I want to thank you from the core of my heart. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Good day. I thought the session was till 1:40. It would have been wonderful to hear something more from you.
Yeah.
But we are calling it off.
Maybe some other time we will do.
Some other time. Good day. Thank you, Seema, ma'am.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to everybody.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.